Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be going through an example of how to compute the normal shock location in the diverging section of a converging diverging nozzle. We're going to be using the same givens from my other video on the pressure ratio delineations for a CD nozzle so that we can use the results from that video. The exit area to throat area ratio is equal to 3, the ratio of the specific heats, gamma, is equal to 1.4, and for this problem we're setting the back pressure to reservoir pressure ratio, or PB over P0, equal to 0.5. From my other pressure ratio delineations video, we got these values for the subsonic isentropic, normal shock at the exit, and the isentropic supersonic PB over P naughts. And we know from that video that in order to get a normal shock in the diverging section of the nozzle, we need the PB over P naught to be in between the subsonic isentropic and the normal shock at the exit, which is why I've chosen 0.5, which you can see it's in between these two values. So first let's look at a schematic of the converging diverging nozzle. Here it is. We have the reservoir here, converging section, and the diverging section. In the reservoir, we have a stagnation pressure P naught. At the minimum area, we have the state T for throat. Here at the exit, we have state E for exit, and it's exhausting into the atmosphere, called state B. And here in blue, we have the normal shock with the state just upstream of the normal shock called state 1, and just downstream of the normal shock called state 2. Also note that we have two independently isentropic sections. So all the way from the reservoir to the normal shock, delta S is equal to 0. It's isentropic. And from behind the normal shock all the way to the exit and into the atmosphere, that's also delta S is equal to 0, or isentropic. However, note that the entropy increases across a normal shock right here, so that it is not isentropic all the way from the reservoir to the exit. Now, before we get into the calculations, I want to go through some of these areas because this is probably the hardest part about doing these problems. So the first one is A sub T, and that's the actual throat area of the nozzle. That's the area right here. A sub NS is the area at the normal shock, so right here. And it's the same for state 1 and state 2 because 1 is just upstream, 2 is just downstream, and so that is the same area. So ANS1 is equal to ANS2, and we'll just call it A sub NS. Now these last two are the confusing ones. So A1 star is the sonic area for the flow upstream of the normal shock, and A2 star is the sonic area for the flow downstream of the normal shock. And although ANS1 was equal to ANS2, A1 star is not equal to A2 star because the flow is non-isentropic across this normal shock. Now when the flow is choked, as it is in this case, or in this example problem, A1 star will be equal to the throat area. Just a few more notes before we get started. The first is again from the previous whiteboard, where the throat area AT is equal to the sonic area at state 1, A1 star, but that is not equal to the sonic area at state 2, A2 star. The second is that in an isentropic flow, the stagnation pressure is constant, so we can say that P naught is equal to P naught 1 because it's isentropic up to that point, and we can also say that P naught 2 is equal to P naught E because it's isentropic up to that point. For this case, because after the shock here, the flow expands to the back pressure at the exit, we can say that the static pressure PB is equal to the static pressure PE. And lastly, there's a couple ways to pose this problem. The first is that we know the shock location in the divergent section of the nozzle, and we're going to find the exit pressure to reservoir pressure, or the back pressure to reservoir pressure, because PB is equal to PE. And then the second way is that we know the back to reservoir pressure, and we're solving for where that shock is in the diverging section of the nozzle, which is A normal shock over A1 star. And since AT is equal to A1 star, we can also write this as ANS over AT. And okay, as a final note, when I say shock location, I'm not actually talking about the location axially along the nozzle where the shock is located. You can see that we're solving for area ratios. So the way that you can relate the area ratio to the actual shock location in the nozzle is if you know the geometry of the nozzle and know how the area ratio changes with the nozzle, then you can compute that and then relate it back to the actual position in the nozzle. The way that I pose this problem is by using the number 2 way down here, which is setting a PB over P naught and solving for the shock location. And the way that you do this is actually by using method 1 here and then iterating on the shock location. So here's the procedure for how we're going to solve this problem. First, we're going to start with a guess for the shock location. And again, when I say shock location, I actually mean the shock area ratio. Number 2 is compute the exit to reservoir pressure, which is the same as the back to reservoir pressure. Step 3 is to compare that value that we just calculated to the desired value. And if they don't match, we need to update the shock location and then go back to step 2, and we'll continue iterating until we're within some error tolerance. After going through the math on the whiteboard here, I'll be showing you my MATLAB GitLab code that I wrote to solve this problem, and in there I use a bisection method to go through these iterations. So the first step, as mentioned on the previous whiteboard, is to set the ANS over A1 star, the shock location, to an initial value, and of course we know that AE over AT is equal to 3 because that's one of the givens. And so what we need to do is we need to solve for PE over P0, again from the previous whiteboard. And so the way that we can do this is to kind of step through the whole nozzle and relate the PE over P0 using some other pressure ratios that we can find more easily. So let's step from the back of the nozzle all the way up to the reservoir. So we're starting with PE because that's what we're trying to find in the numerator. So we can see that the static to stagnation pressure at the exit here. Then we want to get rid of the P0E, so we can relate the P0E to P0II, and that's this here. Then we can relate the stagnation to static pressure at state 2. Then we can relate the static pressures across the normal shock. Then from there we can relate the P1 to P0I, so the static to stagnation at state 1. And then from state 1 all the way to the reservoir, that's P0I over P0. You can see here that we can cross all these out. These all cancel out all the way down so that we get PE over P0 as the final solution from multiplying all these pressure ratios together. Now down here I've indicated what these are all a function of. So this is a function of the exit Mach number. This is equal to 1 because, as we mentioned before, P0E is equal to P0II because it's isentropic from 2 to the exit. This is a function of the downstream Mach number from the normal shock. This is a function of the upstream Mach number. It's a normal shock relation. This is a function of the upstream Mach number M1. And this is equal to 1 because, again, it's isentropic from the reservoir up to before the normal shock, so the stagnation pressure is constant. Since this and this are 1, we can just get rid of them and we can rewrite the PE over P0 down here as these four terms. It's just this with this term and this term taken out, and the goal is to find these four pressure ratios so that we can multiply them together to get PE over P0. I've just rewritten that PE over P0 expression up here for reference. The first thing we want to do is solve for the Mach number upstream of the normal shock at state 1, because you'll note that this will get us both of these pressure ratios here. So we can solve for that Mach number M1 by using the area Mach number relation. I have a video and a blog post on this, and we're going to be using the shock location or shock area ratio that we set at the beginning, the known ratio of specific heats, and we're trying to find the supersonic root because the area Mach number relation gives us both a subsonic and a supersonic root of the Mach number, but we know that upstream of the normal shock, we're going to have a supersonic Mach number. Now that we know the Mach number M1, we can solve for the third and the fourth pressure ratios. So first we'll solve for the fourth one, which is P1 over P0I, and note that P0I is equal to P0, so P1 over P0 is equal to the familiar stagnation to static pressure ratio, and we just have a negative in the exponent because we have a static to stagnation instead of the normal stagnation to static. So we just plug in M1 and gamma, and we can solve for that. So that's taken care of now. Now we move on to this, and this is a normal shock relation. So we have the static pressure ratio across the normal shock, and again, it's only a function of M1 and gamma. Plug those in, and you have this third pressure ratio. The next thing we want to do is use the normal shock relations to compute the downstream Mach number, M2, and so we have M2 is equal to this expression here, and note the 1/2, which is just a square root of whatever is inside these brackets. And then from this downstream Mach number, note that this was only a function of the downstream Mach number and gamma, and so we can compute that second pressure ratio term, P0II over P2, and in this case, note that we don't have that negative in the exponent because this is the stagnation to static, and so we can plug that up into this term. And now the last thing we need to solve for is this term. Now we need to solve for this last pressure ratio here, and this is probably the most confusing one. So to do this, we're going to start by computing AE over A2 star, and in the same way that we made this pressure ratio a function of some pressure ratios that were easier to solve for, we can do the same with this one. So we want an AE on the top, and so we get AE over AT. That's a given. That's our area ratio that we've given at the beginning is equal to 3. Then AT, recall that it's equal to A1 star, so we can write A1 star over ANS, and this is what we guessed at the start. This is the normal shock area ratio at the certain location that we picked at the start, and so that's also known. And then this one here, ANS over A2 star, we can get from the downstream Mach number of the normal shock, and we can get that from the area Mach number relation, which again is a function only of M2 and gamma. So you get that, you plug it in, that's three things that we know. You can solve for this area ratio. Note that the guess from the start was actually ANS over A1 star, so you have to make sure to flip this before multiplying it through. So the reason that we needed to solve for AE over A2 star so that we can get the exit Mach number, and so the exit Mach number we can get from the area Mach number relation, again, using that AE over A2 star that we just calculated, knowing gamma, and knowing that now we want the subsonic route because we know that at the exit, since it's gone through a normal shock, the flow after a normal shock will be subsonic, and then as it keeps increasing in area for a subsonic flow towards the exit, it decreases in velocity further. So we know that we want the subsonic route of the area Mach number relation to get ME. And then finally, we can again use a stagnation to static relationship to get this final term, PE over P naught E is equal to that expression. And again, this one now has a negative in the exponent because instead of it being P naught E over PE, it's flipped, so it's static to stagnation, which gives us this negative exponent. That is the final pressure ratio that we needed to solve for. So this is the final expression for PE over P naught. You just plug in these four ratios that we found previously and you get your final value, which is also equal to PB over P naught because PE is equal to PB. In this case, if you were given the shock location or the area ratio at the shock location, then you're done. This is the final ratio that you were looking for. However, if you were given PB over P naught, which we were in this case at 0.5, then we may need to iterate on the shock location unless we were magically to pick the shock location that matches 0.5 to begin with. So I've written this MATLAB code to solve the problem using the math we've just gone over on the whiteboard. I'll make this available on my GitHub and website, so check the video description for those links. First, we have the knowns for the problem, which are the area ratio is equal to 3, the ratio of specific heats is 1.4, and the set point PB over P naught is 0.5. And then these three sections here are computing the pressure ratio delineations for the subsonic isentropic, supersonic isentropic, and normal shock at the nozzle exit from my previous video. And so the first step is to check that the set point PB over P naught that we have up at the beginning of our knowns here is in fact in between the normal shock at the exit pressure ratio delineation and the subsonic isentropic pressure ratio delineation. So I'm using the bisection method in this code, and you can read my blog post on how to solve the area Mach number relation for a description of how the bisection method works. For a starting point, I'm using the area ratio of the throat, which is just 1, and choosing a value just a little bit above 1. And then for the high area ratio, I'm using the actual exit to throat area ratio, so that's the area ratio of the nozzle. And if the normal shock is indeed in the divergent section of the nozzle, then the normal shock will be somewhere between these low and high. So these low and high initial guesses bound the solution. And so the real crux of the computations here is in this function that I call to solve for the PB over P naught for these three, the low, mid, high, which change throughout the iterations. So if we go into the NS nozzle function, then you can see that down here are all of the values that we computed from the whiteboard. So we're solving for the upstream Mach number, and then the pressure ratios, downstream Mach number, the pressure ratios, the area ratio, exit Mach number. Then we finally end up with this PE over P naught, which is, again, is the same as PB over P naught using these four pressure ratios, again, from the whiteboard. So let's go back to the main script here. And if you go down, you can see that there's also a direct method that I didn't go over, but you can find the derivation in Modern Compressible Flow by Anderson. And so I'm also just computing that here so that we can compare both the iterative and the direct methods, which should give the same result. And so down here I have the section where I print the solutions. Here are the pressure ratio delineations, so we can check those against what we had before on the whiteboard and in the other video. And then here we have the area ratios. First is the iterative, then there's the direct, and then this is the actual nozzle area ratio. So if we run this using function F5, or just F5, then we can check in here the pressure delineation. So we have the subsonic isentropic here, the normal shock at the exit here, and the isentropic supersonic, and we can see that our normal shock in the nozzle is indeed between the subsonic and the normal shock at the exit. And then in the area ratios, we can see that it solved for the area ratio of the shock in the nozzle, and it is indeed in between 1, which would be the throat, and 3, which is actually at the exit area. And so it's at, in this case, 2.33973, and the iterative and the direct both compute the same value. And while we're here, we might as well check a couple things. You can see that we should still have a normal shock in the nozzle if we're between this value and this value. So let's bump up our PB over P naught set point up to a value that's close to this, so maybe 0.96. And if we do that, then we should have a normal shock that is closer to 1, closer to the throat. So let's go back up to the knowns up here, and we'll do 0.96, and I'll run it again. And now you can see that our area ratio for both the iterative and the direct has indeed bumped down closer to the throat. And then similarly, we can bump it down to just above the normal shock at the exit. So let's put like 0.3 3.8, for example, and this should bring it out closer to 3. And so if we run this again, now you can see that, yep, we're at 2.975. Now, as a final note, if you are given the normal shock location in the nozzle, all you have to do is plug it into here, into the function, and that gives you your exit to reservoir pressure ratio, and you're done. And so this has been a video on finding the location of a normal shock in a converging diverging nozzle. Thanks for watching.